Welcome. I had like all day to prepare for that too.
All you have to do is say welcome, everybody.
That's it, you're out of here.
Okay.
We're live.
Welcome everyone to episode 500 of Paul's Security Weekly. I suppose I'm supposed to have something funny and interesting to say, and I suppose I just said something funny and interesting. Well, at least I said the words. There is a cast of characters here for episode 500, and rather than do a marathon, we decided to, I don't know why, but to bring together many of our friends from the security community to do a podcast with 12 people on it. So buckle your seatbelts. This is episode 500. This is Security Weekly, for security professionals by security professionals. Broadcasting live from G-Unit Studios in Rhode Island, it's the show where exploits run wild, packets aren't the only things getting sniffed, and the cocktails flow steady. It's Paul's Security Weekly.
To you by gain control of cyber risk with Tenable IO, the first vulnerability management platform built for today's elastic assets like cloud, containers, and web apps. Discover a fresh asset-based approach that prioritizes vulnerabilities while seamlessly integrating into your environment. Improve ROI with the first elastic licensing approach based on assets, not IP addresses. Tenable IO delivers the data and context you need to secure your elastic attack surface. Start your free Tenable IO trial by visiting tenable.io. The average time between being hacked and realizing you've been hacked is 1 year. Can you afford to let an intruder roam your network for that long? Can your company weather the fallout when this comes to light? Black Hills Information Security can help find the bad guys in your network and train you to do it yourself. Email consulting@blackhillsinfosec.com to find out how a hunt teaming engagement can help you find a persistent threat in your network. The SANS Institute, the most trusted source for computer certification training and research. Visit sans.org to explore their full curriculum and latest training offers.
Welcome, everyone, to Paul's Security Weekly, episode 500. Everyone cheer and clap now. Yay!
We're all muted.
But and they all ate Robin's Minstrels.
Help, someone please get us. Paul trapped us here in a snowstorm.
Yeah, I did. I've trapped everyone here in a snowstorm in Rhode Island in G-Unit Studios. And we had a lot of fun today. As I said before, we decided not to do an all-day marathon podcast. You can thank me for that later because we've done them, and it's a lot of work. So we decided to just do a regular episode and have everyone on it who could make it here in the snow. I want to thank everyone for coming today and being on the show. I also want to give a big round of applause to the Security Weekly staff for putting this event together. I really had like very little to do with it. Like, Paul, just show up, look pretty, drink, and at least I got the drinking part, and do a podcast like you always do. So round of applause for the Security Weekly staff.
Yay.
For making this happen.
Thank you,
everyone. Mark, Riley, Allison, Tyler, Keith, all put in a lot of work into this episode. So thank you very much. We've got a lot of people here. Why don't we just go around and just give a brief introduction and tell me your favorite color, or no, not your favorite color. What Security Weekly means to you? I'll start to my left, Mr. Jeff Mann.
Well, hi, I'm Mr. Jeff Mann. What does Security Weekly mean to me? Everything.
I love you, man. Love you, man.
I'm Don Pizzette with IT Pro TV, and Security Weekly means to me learning something practically applicable, not fundamentals in theory, right? You know, something we can actually use out there in the real world, and it's great to have a source for that.
Awesome.
I am Scott Lyons. I am with War Collar Industries, and what security means to me, Security Weekly, sorry, is it's a chance to really connect with other people in the industry, especially with the people sitting at this table.
Hi, this is Josh Marpet, and Security Weekly, really simply, it's the voice of my community. Thank you.
Allison Nixon, I'm at Flashpoint. Security Weekly to me means seeing old friends that I haven't seen in a million years and who I miss, and it's just so great to see you guys again.
We miss you too. Love.
Aww. Love you guys.
Love, love.
I'm John Strand. I have three families in computer security. I have Black Hills Information Security. I have SANS. And I have Paul Security Weekly. And
then your own family somewhere after that. Right? Oh, no.
Oh, sorry. Yeah.
Thanks.
He's
for
now dead.
Bringing that up.
To them, at least.
But no, it is absolutely family, and it's a place to call home.
I'm Tyler Robinson.
Who are
again,
you with?
In Guardians.
Okay.
Thanks. Appreciate that, John. Security Weekly is kind of real near and dear to my heart. I started, obviously, in security not too long ago, and this was where the dream really started for me, coming from the defensive side and moving through, you know, the various stages of the SANS training, right up into InGuardian's red team, which, you know, it couldn't have been possible without a lot of the experience and things that were paved on the show. You know, obviously there's a lot of drinking and fun, and this is a second family, but it really does mean a lot to, I think, a lot of people coming up in the industry and the next generation of people that the torch is going to get passed to. And so it does mean quite a bit to be here on the, you know, I've been here since the beginning, and 500, wow, is a real honor.
Thanks, Tyler.
And the torch now is an IoT device.
That's right.
That was beautiful, Tyler. Beautiful. This is Ed Skotus with the SANS Institute and CounterHack. Paul Security Weekly, what does it mean to me? It means fun, means friends, family, and learning. I've learned so much on this show over the years. It is wonderful.
Thank you, Ed.
So it's hard to follow that, but this is Geoff Thayer, co-host of Security Weekly, also a member of Black Hills Information Security. Security Weekly means to me certainly family, fun, all the things that everybody else has said, but also, just a great sense of community and learning, and a way to connect with a lot of great people.
Hi. My name's Larry Pesci, and I do this Security Weekly thing and work for InGuardians and have all sorts of fun stuff. What does Security Weekly mean to me? Well, I don't know. It's a really good question. I don't think I've ever really thought about what it means to me, but I know that it's a lot of hard work. And it's a really great way for me to give back to the community that's given so much to me. And I'm still amazed that to this day, going into episode 500, that, hey, we put this thing out there and people actually listen to this crap.
My mom's watching, by the way.
Good. I mean,
she used to be the only one that watched.
I remember those days. And yeah, we put this thing out there how many years ago, Paul? And we started doing this, and it was, hey, you know what? Maybe if we put this out there, somebody will listen. It turns out they listened a lot.
Mm-hmm.
So,
how many years ago was it?
This is our 12th year. 12 years.
Yep.
And our hope is that they hear as well as listen.
No.
Yeah.
Oh.
And learn.
Found.
Wow.
Great.
Right, next up.
Yeah.
Paul Simon.
Greg Foss with Logarithm. I think Security Weekly to me is something that I've been following ever since I got into the industry, and I think it's kind of a cornerstone and a foundational aspect of the industry now. And it's really cool being here for the 500th episode. Well,
hear, hear. Well, thanks everyone for listening, watching, and of course to all of you who have influenced the show in some way. Of course, many people couldn't be here that have influenced the show, but the 12 or 13 of us, I don't know, there's an empty seat over there somehow. But
he moved.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Maybe we can get Doug White to come in. Doug, we have a seat for you. I know Doug is here, so feel free to pop in. I know we started off like in a kind of a somber note, but we're going to talk about IoT security, which is certainly going to get more lively and entertaining as it's a hot topic, a hot issue today. Go ahead, Doug. You can sit down. Doug, why don't you sit down and introduce yourself? We're just going to talk about IoT security. Doug's going to introduce himself. Actually, many of you may not know Doug. Doug started working with Security Weekly, but Doug's awesome. Welcome, Doug.
Hi, this is Doug.
Get a little closer to the mic, Doug.
Closer to the mic.
There you go.
I'm close.
There you go.
Yeah. I'm Doug White from Roger Williams University. Security Weekly is something that I've directed myself and many people to over the years, trying to get them involved in security when we're preaching the gospel. So it's a very important show, and I think it's introduced lots and lots of people to these topics and a lot of the people in the industry, especially people that are just getting involved in it and don't know anybody, and a lot of corporate people who don't know who. I've had people email me and say, who is this guy? And I'm like, oh, you want to know that guy, or you don't want to know that guy, or whatever, depending on who you're talking about. So it's like, yeah.
You're talking about Paul, right?
Of course. I just didn't want to say that, but I thought I'd let you guys say that.
Well, thank you, Doug. So let's start by talking about IoT security. I mean, this is the foundation of the show. You talked about being a foundation for the industry, which is a very kind words. I'm very thankful for that, to have people view the show that way. But the foundation of the show is we get together and drink and talk about security.
I think that's been the thing since day one.
Since day one, since episode one, that's what we've done. And we're going to continue that tradition for 500 episodes and beyond. So the thing with IoT security that is really interesting to me, not interesting, but actually somewhat depressing, is everyone at this table and many of us listening, we've all identified these problems before. We've all said, you know, these embedded systems, these small devices, security basically really sucks on them. So what I want to, how did we get to today? How did we get today where it's such an issue? What has changed over time to bring what we used to look at printers and multifunction devices and wireless routers when Larry and I wrote the book, right? To take it from an issue that we were kind of all looking at, but now every mainstream media and press is covering IoT security.
I'm going to make the joke here, Paul, and that you ask what has changed, and I might argue that nothing has changed.
Mm. Yep. Mm-hmm. I think it's like a snowball of crap, right? You know,
we can make lots of snowballs outside.
We could.
Maybe so not a crap ball.
You go back, and I've talked about this sometimes at conferences. You go back to 2000, 2001. How many apps did you have on your desktop? How many IoT-level devices did you have? And the years go by, and you keep on adding more technology, more and more software, and more IoT, and it keeps on adding into organizations, and it gets bigger, and it gets bigger, and it gets bigger, and things are almost ever removed. And I think that we finally hit that kind of critical inflection point where there's so much crap out there to be exploited that is old, or they're still using the exact same technology, firmware, background software, that it's finally getting to the point where I keep asking, are people now realizing just how bad it is? And I think that yes, I think that people are just now starting to realize how big that snowball has gotten.
And I think the major change here, the one moment that started the avalanche, was when somebody realized that there's actually a profit motive in this. Mm. Because these machines have always been breakable and crappy and everything, but there wasn't any clear profit motive attached to it. And then somebody figured out, hey, I can use these to DDoS stuff, and that is worth money, and now this is a thing.
And you have one of those things here, if those are watching the video. Why don't you tell everyone, Allison, since you kind of have the ball at the moment, what did you bring to the studio, which is awesome, or access to a device, right?
Yeah.
Or a little bit of both.
Yeah, I brought one DVR to the studio, but I also have one in my own lab. And basically what it is it's this really old DVR. It's used in, this sort of stuff is used in CCTV systems, security systems, and things like that. And a lot of these have an open telnet service with a username and password of root and XC3511. And what I have set up is I have one of these devices with port 23 forwarded to the device, and I'm looking at the telnet sessions that are coming in. So this is actually a live feed of everything that's logging into my DVR and trying to hack into it.
Now,
and
I can't help but notice on a technical note that one of the first commands an attacker has run is rm-rf upnp.
Oh, Oh, no, that's actually the last command that's being run on this telnet session. So what it's doing is, like, that big blob of text up there at the top, that's the attacker writing a binary line by line and appending it to a file called UPnP. And what is because these DVRs don't have telnet. They don't have WGET, sorry. Mm-hmm. So in order to fetch the second stage loader, they are compiling WGET, like a really tiny version of it, appending it to a custom named file, and then executing the file. And then once the DVR runs that executable, it will fetch the file and then download it, and then that is the actual payload. So what this is doing is it's compiling the file, or like putting it together and then executing it and then removing the file. And what that does is it basically removes traces of it off the DVR so that other people can't come in
and get things down, right?
Yeah. Well, no, they can't like come in and figure out, oh, hey, this is the other guy that owns this DVR. I'm going to like use this and take down their botnet, because there's turf wars too. So they're removing their own malware from the DVR so that it's harder to find. So like, it's fascinating watching this stuff go on, because there are territorial conflicts over DVRs.
Wow.
That's amazing. And now this is the Mirai botnet?
Yeah. I mean, Mirai is open source now, so there's a bunch of different variants. But a lot of this, like this big blob of binary stuff that came up, they call it an echo loader, and that's probably the best term for it.
Yep.
They echo strings over command line into a file, which in this case is called retrieve, and then it executes retrieve, which loads the file from the remote location, ergo echo loader.
You know, when Larry and I were writing the book on WOT54G routers, I had this like thought, like I woke up in the middle of the night and I was like, you know, it'd be really bad if someone were to figure out how to get, first of all, payloads to all these devices. Because we were finding all these, you know, now we call them IoT devices, have all these different processor architectures. And that was one of the limiting factors. I'm like, it'd be really bad if someone like created some universal binaries or even like pre-compiled a dozen or so, so they'd run on all these systems.
And that's exactly what they do. They cross-compile.
It's like they were in my head. It's frightening.
You do it?
And it read your mind, Paul.
Was that
and
you?
So long to execute. It's not funny.
It's not me.
Wait a minute.
I feel like it could, because I read what they do, and I'm like, Why? Yeah. Like I thought about how like bad that could be, and I'm like, wow, it's like happening now. Like this is really bad.
Yeah,
sounds like
is.
A confession to me.
Larry had an interesting point. It took them so long to execute that sort of plan. When do you think you had that dream, that horror show?
It was like in 2007 when we were finishing the book.
Yeah.
Okay, so then it took them until when to put this stuff out there?
9 years.
So 9 years. So why did it take them so long?
Was it just that the targets were...
Obviously, they didn't read the
I would
the
say
book.
It took 6 years.
But is okay. it that there are more of these targets on the internet? Is it that the more people have bandwidth connected to these targets? Or is it... Did they just get tired of popping websites in people's Windows computers?
I think it's cycles and focus. Like, for example, you remember Apache vulnerabilities... Everyone was looking at Apache, and we had like 3-4 big ones. Right. Probably a better one would be Acrobat, right? There was
we're still having that problem.
Still are, but it's not as fast and furious as it was back in 2009, 2010.
Agreed.
So it's almost like the entire community, whenever something like Adobe Acrobat or Flash or Java, they all focus on this specific area, and then it's kind of like they lose interest, and then all of a sudden they switch over and they start hitting something else. And it almost feels like right now everyone's focusing on IoT because it is very, very easy to attack. There's tons of vulnerabilities in different devices.
Wait, you're saying Flash isn't easy to attack?
I think it's just an issue that they move on. I think that, you know, once the dinner bell is rung, that this particular area is an easy area to attack. You see everyone focus on that, and then eventually something comes up and they're going to shift off again. I don't think that the core issue has been addressed. Like, Flash is pretty still insane. So is Java. And a lot of people are stopping using those technologies outright. But I think this is just the vulnerability surface du jour.
Well, we've seen this in the past, actually, with the gold rushes in California and in Alaska. You know, once the valleys run dry, everybody moves on to the next great thing, you know? And then came everything else that drove the current market to where it is. And we're going to start to see that shift here very shortly as well.
Yeah, but you've got PDFs are still vulnerable to, oh my God, how many things. Flash is still vulnerable. A lot of these things are still vulnerable. Mm-hmm. So the valleys aren't running dry, mm-hmm. but you're still seeing the, I like that, the attack surface du jour. I really like that.
We just have a whole lot more valleys.
The other one is skills transfer. One of the reasons that becomes more pronounced, I mean, we've seen it just repeats, is at one point you're thinking about it. and maybe five people are thinking about it. And today, anybody that wants, that even hears about it, can jump on, they can find a reference to it with instructions on how to do it, and they start expanding on that. So I think that drives more people into those focus areas as well, because you can look it up.
And I think this is actually a really good thing for new people in the industry, because there's wave after wave of technology. I remember when I first started in the industry, firewalls were like a big, exciting thing. And
no.
That Java.
Ed, when you started the industry, fire was a big thing.
We like fire.
See?
The invention of the wheel. Yes.
Exaggeration with the age jokes.
So the point, though, is if you're new in this industry, grab one of these waves, right? Especially when it's starting. IoT is big and exciting now. There's a whole bunch of new emerging technologies. And you can learn a lot and contribute meaningfully. Start writing blogs, get some stuff in the lab, hack all the things, right?
Well, it's a matter of time until somebody starts developing machine learning attack vectors.
No, that's already happening.
It's already happening?
Well, one of the things that I also find interesting, sort of along those lines, is back in 2007, I would have dreams that I'd wake up and I go, you know, these are juicy targets because no one pays attention to them. There's no AV. There's no alerting. If I break into someone's home router and it functions like a home router, no one's going to know I'm there. And I can do whatever I want with it. And then
and
Mirai happened,
bad,
and I'm
goes,
like,
bad goes
damn
wrong,
it.
No one will care.
Yeah.
And then they'll just throw it away and buy a new one anyway, and you can just come back and attack the new one.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Well, and one of my the other concern that I have, especially with vendors, is, and the industry as a whole, is that a lot of people look at vulnerabilities in these devices, vulnerabilities in Flash. Like you said, there's still vulnerabilities in Flash. There's still vulnerabilities in Java. Those things aren't going away. They look at it as an Easter egg hunt, as though somehow if we find all the vulnerabilities, there won't be any more Easter eggs and things will be secure. And that's kind of what happens. But I do agree, Ed, this is a great place for people to step in, find the way, find the next wave, preferably. Try to jump in early, and then you can develop a really good name for yourself, because you know, if you show up with a Flash 0 day or a Java 0 day, and you try to show up at a con and be like, "Hey, look, I've got a 0 day for Flash," people are going to look at you and be like, "Who doesn't?"
So does everyone else. Yeah,
dude, you're like 10 years ago called and wants their exploits back.
But then there are people that make talks and make almost careers out of the 1990s are back again, and oh my God, it's better than ever because nobody's looking for that stuff anymore. I've seen a half a dozen talks about that in the last year or so. And so you've got, we've got a cyclical problem. We've got attack surfaces. I love that term, dude. That's awesome, John. Attack surface du jour. We have attack surface du jours that come back again over and over and over again. So you can jump on the latest wave, like Ed, like you said. You can jump on an older wave, but then somebody might mock you because Larry doesn't mock anybody ever.
Ever.
Except me every week, but, you know.
Well, details. but you earn it.
That's true. So,
glutton for punishment.
Slow-hanging fruit.
Well, and, you know,
thanks, Josh.
And it's that cyclical nature of it. Like, everyone thinks that IoT hacking is some kind of brand new field in hacking, where in reality, if you've been in this industry for long enough, you're like, this is hacking like 1999-level stuff.
Except I think the difference is today, the devices are more powerful, and people have more bandwidth connected to them, which means they're going to use it for DDoS. I also think, and I want to get the group's opinion on this, what about ransomware of these devices? We've seen smatterings of it. What if that becomes more commonplace?
I think it's going to, especially with the industrial Internet of Things. Can you imagine saying to a factory manager, do you want to produce product today? If so, you have to pay me. Mm. And then your IIoT, industrial Internet of Things stuff, will come back on.
Well, I think that's
very compelling.
That's
business
the big
model.
Thing that's changed, and we started the conversation with, you know, the bad guys have figured out how to monetize this, and that's really what's changed. I mean, we all know we're talking about how this stuff's been there and it's been there for years, and the possibility has been there, but now bad guys are figuring out how to make money out of it.
So I'm skeptical about the ransomware IoT idea. Now, I mean, I can't say for the industrial stuff, but right now when people are talking about problems with IoT, a lot of it is coming from these modems, routers, DVRs that are being abused right now with malware. And with these types of embedded Linux devices, there's not a lot of persistence on there. So there's not really a lot of data on there that you would want to ransom anyways.
So you just wipe it and start over.
Exactly. Reboot, and there's no ransomware. So, I mean, ransomware kind of requires that there's some kind of critical function that the device performs that can be permanently reversed.
Reversed.
Yeah, so like when you've got your desktop computer, you've got all this important data that you need. So the ransomware will encrypt it, and now you can't have the data without decrypting it.
Here I go giving people ideas. What if in the firmware...
It'll take nine years for them to implement it.
If I persist my malware in the bootloader...
That's not an idea. That's a reality. I know somebody who did that. But in the IoT devices, if my malware is in the bootloader, even if you put new firmware on it, it's still going to just keep...
That's a lot easier said than done. Like, in practice, writing firmware for these types of devices without bricking them outright is really not that easy. And that's probably the most likely path for persistence for these things. Mm-hmm. But a lot of these are like sub-$100 devices. You can't really ransom them for that much anyways.
Well, right. No. And that's not them. It's the information they control.
But a lot of these devices don't have persistent storage. So like your router, your modem, your DVR, like...
They don't have persistent storage, but when I can buy a $50 router that does things that, you know, the tricked out things you guys were doing 9 years ago couldn't even think of doing, I can transfer information from you to me.
All of that being said, the bigger problem, I think, is the inconsistency of the attack surface. If you're going to try to monetize something, right? If you're going to try to monetize ransomware, Windows is a perfect target because everybody's running Windows, right? If you're going to try to do an IoT, like, ransomware attack, what you need to do is you need to have a very good platform that impacts a large amount of organizations that you can write the firmware to. Otherwise, you're going to be writing 1z2z firmware, you're going to be writing 1z2z malware. And yeah, that may work great for DDoS attacks because you can hit them all, take them over, launch the attack. You have a very perishable amount of time where you can actually use that effectively in an attack. But from a ransomware perspective, you would have to write literally hundreds of different malware specimens, hundreds of different persistence mechanisms, and everything that goes back to what the data is going through, well, that would be very, very particular to each of the organizations. True. It's almost like phones, you know, in a large way, especially with Android. The consistency of the platform that you're attacking isn't as consistent as we would like it to be for, like, malware and rootkits and things of that nature. It's entirely possible, but... When you go from device to device to device to device, it's not as ubiquitous to jump.
And that's why I jumped to the industrial side of these things. I've been thinking about this problem a lot. How can somebody create ransomware for IoT? And you're right, Allison, there's not much to encrypt there. And, you know, crypto ransomware is very successful because it doesn't need C2. Your customers call you if you're the bad guy, right? They say, hey, how do I decrypt this? I think with the industrial thing, you have some consistency over something that's very valuable, staying in production. And there is something to encrypt. You encrypt the management infrastructure and the architecture of the darn thing, because it's going to take you a lot of time to rebuild that. Not the individual devices, because their persistence is kind of wonky. But instead, I want to shut the factory down. So I go after that. And traditional ransomware might allow me to do that without even touching the IoT devices. I go after the HMI and the architecture and all of that. So I think there might be something there. Maybe 9 years from now, if Paul dreams about it, we'll
see. Well, and one of my other dreams from earlier is that people would compromise.
Don't tell us about that dream.
I know.
Oh, not that one. But someone would compromise a wireless router, use that as a jumping off point to compromise the next wireless router and be on the inside of the network, right? I mean, many of the problems we see lately are because people don't, like, use a firewall properly to go back to your thing, Ed. However, even if we did fix that problem, some of the reports I'm seeing is that my Android phone gets infected and it ransomwares your TV, or it compromises your router and changes your DNS settings. And when we get to that level, like, what happens? Does that make these things more of a reality?
I think Skynet. Attribution is something that's not being considered either from IoT, from a political standpoint.
Drink.
he said attribution.
He brought it up first.
The other thing, the
ability for people to be able to attribute something, you know, where all these thousands of $50 devices are sitting out there at mom and pa's shop, you know, how are you going to trace three hops through something that has no persistence, which is the true value to, say, you know, nation state, NSA, you know, whoever, utilizing these devices as a means to an end, maybe going after the industrial control.
I think it's important to have a fix, too. So let's go back to my TV example. I want to watch TV at my house, but my phone got infected, and it's infecting my TV. And then I either pay the ransom, or maybe I just put the firmware, reinstall it on my TV, and now I don't have it anymore. But then my phone's just reinfecting my TV. So in that respect, I think there is a valid case for ransomware.
And there are situations where that can be very possible, especially whenever you're looking at whenever you start unifying protocols that are being used. And I'm not necessarily talking about TCP/IP or anything like that. But if you start looking at Flash, if you start looking at HTML5, you start looking at these different technologies, my phone runs HTML5, my computer runs HTML5, Linux runs HTML5, the Mac runs HTML5. Right. So you start having these protocols and these applications that are consistent across your phone, your DVR, and I think that type of attack now starts becoming more possible.
And recently, they used that same technology as a jumping off point to compromise printers. I don't know if you've been following this hacking-printers.net.
Yeah.
I think that's another very scary thing. But
that was a matter of time before printers started getting taken out.
It's true.
Yeah, but just isn't the thing that's underlying this, I mean, just to weigh in for a minute, you know, we had a long period of history where there was one predominant operating system that was getting attacked, right? It was the Microsoft Windows operating system, and they hardened and they hardened and they hardened and they got more mature. And all of these other operating systems we were dealing with, those were embedded printers, there were phones that were developing, there were IoT devices that were developing. They did not harden their base stack. And now we're seeing diversity move out into those different areas, and we're seeing sort of history repeat itself because of that. Right? Because
you're
that
talking about the whole
I'm still on the
industrial firmware, because I think the bigger targets are these big juicy targets that are politicized, because those are very standard. So you're not getting this just collection of random attack surfaces. You've got somebody like the U.S. military buying a million motherboards. They're not buying 50 or 50,000. They're buying huge numbers, and they're putting them in many, many devices that have great value in some sort of attack vector that's coming from a nation state or even a group. And as we all know, if somebody sets it up, somebody else will figure it out. So to me, there's two threat vectors there. There's one from this just sort of nation state, you know, persistent threat. But there's also the idea that the nation state can't protect the secret that they embedded in the chipsets, and then some 12-year-old kid figures it out, and it gets distributed, and suddenly it gets weaponized on a whole different level. And that's this big, juicy ransomware vector where you shut down all the tanks in the U.S. Army, you know, as a sort of silly example, but they shut all the tanks down they call and say, we need $50 million in Bitcoin. Well, that sounds, now I sound, now US I sound
government.
Like Dr. Evil.
Would you like to fight terror today?
$100 million.
But $50 million isn't very much.
Let's go to $500 billion.
There's kind of a cool offshoot of what Tyler was talking about, what you're talking about, Doug, and that is, if you're a nation state trying to attack somebody for whatever reason, right, you want to disguise your stuff as just run-of-the-mill ransomware because you don't want attribution. It seems to me, if you're not making your stuff look kind of like ransomware, should it get detected, you're not doing your job quite right, right? To avoid attribution.
Well, you remember we created that super fun time happy APT generator where it would take your malware and it would automatically put like Russian characters or Chinese characters.
Of course.
So we did that, and that thing got DOSed very quickly. because we know that a lot of people in DFIR are like, oh, wow, there's Russian, so it must be Russian malware. And that attribution is a big part. But another question kind of going with, aside from attribution, is triage. I think that computer security as a whole, we've given up on the home user, right? We know that there's no way we can protect the home user because they shut off their AV, they never install patches, they hate doing anything. And what are we seeding IoT in this community? And if we decide that we actually want to fight, and this gets to how do we fix this, we know it's broken, okay? How do we actually approach the problem of IoT security? Because it is so incredibly diverse, because there's so many vendors that just don't exist anymore, because there's so many companies that are running software that don't have security programs. Is it even possible for us to try to, quote, secure the IoT problem whatsoever?
That's a really good point, John. And actually, I like the way you put it. We've given up on the home user, because this whole IoT problem, I mean, a lot of it is the home user coming back with a vengeance, because the people that are running these machines, like when the really big Mirai DDoS attacks were happening, when we looked at where the attacks were coming from, the actual IPs sending the traffic, a lot of it was like shopkeepers in Vietnam. Like, these are the threat vectors. People who just have this dusty machine in a corner somewhere that they forgot about for the past few years, and now it's attacking a video game.
Damn. So what's stopping
us? Picture of a dusty router in one of my presentations from 2010.
So, question: what's stopping somebody from putting out a white hat virus that goes out and patches everything?
It's called Wifotch, and that's actually been done. It also doesn't do a very good job of it, and now it's just more background noise.
Yeah, and that's what I was going to say. You know, it seems like somebody has attempted to patch everything, and if it did work, Mirai wouldn't have happened.
No, because these machines are so vulnerable, and like, it's not like there's one flaw. It's actually like Swiss cheese. So you can't really patch these things. Like, even if you theoretically could do whatever you want to these embedded devices, you can't make enough persistent changes to these machines to patch them.
Right. But can you, can you send them a message like Stack Overflow did by spitting out all those messages on printers for people to fix them?
But just a minute, on Mirai, though, correct me if I'm wrong, but wasn't the entry point for Mirai default credentials, basically? I mean, if I read the source code, I looked it through, the entry point was default creds, right?
About 40 odd
credentials. You know, that's not that hard to change.
That's what you would think.
right. Okay, point taken, Allison. You would think people would change the credentials, and they don't. I understand.
So, Ed, let me know if I hit all the.
It's also impossible to on some of these.
Let me know if I hit all the bullet points in a slide from 3 years ago. Look, whenever you start talking about worms that are going out and trying to patch things, there's a couple of problems. First, you have the issue of liability. Who actually puts this out? Is it the government? And if they do end up patching something, changing the password, updating the firmware, and things crash, who's responsible if that device actually crashes? The second thing is, if we have something that's spreading like a DDoS attack, and all of a sudden we're trying to now attack large sections of the internet, we're also using up bandwidth whenever bandwidth is something that we need at that point. So in a general opinion of an InfoSec luminary from years ago, and I believe this too, this is a bad idea. This is a freaking horrible idea of going out and writing malware and trying to fix the problem. Because almost any time that we do that, it's going to run into issues inevitably.
And not to mention the author usually ends up in federal prison. Or at least under events.
But could you? I agree. I'm on board. It's a terrible idea. I don't like it because it's a liability thing to me. It's just like, who's going to pay when I brick somebody's medical system at their house and they die? Because juries love that kind of stuff. But maybe that's where this starts lending itself to this sort of EMT type response units that we start hearing about, where we actually do have city, state, towns kind of infrastructure. We're starting to have law enforcement people who actually know what we're talking about in this show. I mean, 15 years ago, nobody knew that. But if we could start building together, we start building together teams, and we've been doing that in Rhode Island. We've been working with law enforcement. We've been working with all kinds of agencies to start building those units where we can bring people in and fix it in a localized way. So now it's like putting out a fire. So instead of saying we're just going to flood the whole country to keep fires from starting, we say, here's something bad happening. We need to develop things like that worm, but that we can target, you know, weaponize it, target it locally, and say we're going to shut it down right here in this area so we can get things back under control without just saying turn it all loose and go crazy.
And you bring up a really interesting point there. Getting back to the, well, we've abandoned the home user point, right? It's going to take a cultural shift to really see an impact on the state of security, on how things work now. Absolutely. And that cultural impact is a generational shift. Right, much like we're starting to see right now with executives that are coming up, the young executives that are being groomed, that understand the pain of having their devices locked out or not being able to watch the latest Family Guy. Right, that's what it's going to take.
Scott, where's the cultural shift? Is it on the end user population, or is it on the corporations that are producing these devices?
I'm not sure if it's shifting in the direction that you're implying and that it's shifting.
So looking at IoT, though, and the problem of IoT and, you know, hey, we want to patch this, I think it goes much further past that. You can't just, it's like we've been telling corporations for years when we're doing pen tests, you have to have this defense in depth strategy. You can't be relying on patching because that's only effective until the next exploit or the next 12-year-old kid breaks that, you know, next IoT. We've got to have some kind of system, and I think it's going to have to be outside, you know, outside of the box thinking. How do we segment these? How do we make a new IP space for them? How do we start layering our defenses and building a new, you know, IoT framework where we're actually securing an entire stack?
We've talked quite a bit on several shows about codes and regulation, which was like the electrical codes. And the way they stopped a lot of fires in the United States was by implementing electrical codes on buildings to keep people from hand wiring things and wiring all kinds of stuff up.
Yeah.
So what that part of it is then when you find people that are violating, so that may be the worm that actually doesn't do anything, but it goes out and detects these things and says, well, here's somebody that's got all these vulnerabilities, and then you get notified by, not by me and not by, you know, some 12-year-old kid, but you get notified by the state police
unit that says you need to fix this or we're going to come by and do something about it, just like they would with electrical
violations. That kind of goes back to the, most people make this assumption that somebody else is taking care of security, right? As a consumer, when I buy that Nest webcam, I assume they're doing the security. And hey, maybe the people that are making the Foscam, IP camera, whatever, they assume that you're going to secure your network. And the reality is that nobody's doing either, right? And so would it kill us to whitelist devices? Would it kill us to have outbound, God forbid, outbound firewall rules? Would it kill us to do that stuff?
I think it would.
We're reaching that point where you're not going to have a choice. That we're going to have to start requiring that.
I love the outbound firewall rules things. It'd be great. And I was talking to a gentleman the other day.
Will it interfere with my cat pics?
So this is the deal, that the gentleman has this router from his provider that has this great list of permit all these protocols out, and then the last rule in the firewall is IP permit any.
Yeah, what's the point, right?
Because they want everything to work. And then you take that line out, and then
how many people
works.
At this table have been to a Fortune 500 company and seen any on a firewall
this week?
This week, nice.
Okay, so for those that didn't see that,
right
all
now,
of us.
Every hand at the table.
But this also gets into a larger issue, right? I personally am okay with insecure IoT devices. I am personally okay with these vulnerabilities existing.
You just like being watched.
Going to be watched by somebody, and that's the point.
He's John Strand. He's very voyeuristic. If you Google image search him, you'll know that.
Yeah, I'm constantly trying to figure out how to put
only
on my
from your
own
personal
pants.
Flicker.
And the reason why I'm okay with that is the alternative is not okay with me. Because if we start going down this legislation, if we start going through and we have bots that are scanning the internet, looking for internet security holes, and trying to filter out ports and trying to filter out protocols, then the internet isn't crazy and weird anymore. It doesn't have that freedom of creativity of doing really bizarre things. That's a trade-off.
But we do need a more secure infrastructure of all these different devices. And I don't know if we're going to get there from regulation, but I'm very excited about the prospect of recalls. They recalled some of the devices we were talking about earlier.
Well,
the
there was lawsuits by the FCC and the FTC against companies recently, which was the first time I really ever saw a government regulatory body take action. Now, albeit some will criticize and say the FTC will come on strong and then be like, no, it's really fine. But I think it's an important step.
And the recalls that may be driven from that will cause those companies to try to secure their infrastructure in advance. And this should be for egregious security flaws.
You are being so incredibly optimistic.
But they will simply shut the grand down. Look, I think all the other stuff's going to fail. I think the recalls,
I disagree.
It's one possibility.
Look. Actually, Allison told me about this before. The Florian, whatever it is, DVRs that you were talking about, they just go in and out of business and buy the same components with a different business name.
The big company behind it, it's XM or whatever they call themselves.
They're not even in the United States. They don't give two craps about what the FTC
says. They did issue a recall, though, and that's cool because that cost them money. And I think fundamentally this has to be either a government regulation issue.
So how is that recall going to work, actually? Because that was a little bit weird.
Right.
The DVR that I have does not have that company's name on it anywhere.
Right. True. But if there's any recall of some of the devices somewhere, that's going to cost them money, and they have to take that into account in advance. It's going to drive the behavior we want. So I encourage people to vigorously.
I disagree because look, doctors for years, small doctors' offices paid $1,000 or $1,500 a year to do because they weren't HIPAA compliant as a cost of doing business. They didn't bother becoming HIPAA compliant. So you're saying a recall, which is going to cost them less than their profit for
30 years. What Ed is saying is whenever you have HIPAA and you have high tech and you actually have fines being leveraged against hospitals, and there are fines being leveraged against hospitals.
Not for years, they weren't.
But that's what's driving the change in a lot of places.
You have to raise the cost of being insecure. How are you going to raise that cost?
Perceived cost.
Fair enough.
Yeah,
but how are you going to raise that cost? Right now, government regulation, we can talk about that all we want. I just don't see it happening.
I agree.
So what else you got? I got recalls. It was a recall of an automobile.
The irony of government regulation is most of us at the table, most in the industry, go on and on about how stupid government regulation is. It misses the mark. Oh, we hate it. Blah, blah, blah.
If the NSA is watching, it's
and
just
yet,
him.
And yet, we're talking about that being one of the possible solutions for this IoT problem. I like the idea, though. I mean, it's all, at the end of the day, it's all economics.
It is, exactly.
So if you can come up with a way of making it economically feasible for a vendor or a provider to fix an IoT device because it's perceived to be cheaper than the alternative,
yes.
Right?
Now
then
we're talking.
But then you're getting
the point.
Somewhere.
Right. When HIPAA fines were raised enough to make a difference, that's when things started to get HIPAA compliant. I'm not saying medical is part of this. I'm just using this example,
and
just to
that's,
be clear.
That's what I meant by regulation. Not necessarily like a building code, but more of a mechanism to allow liability to be focused. Because if anybody will take care of it, it's insurers. Because if you can't get underwriting, the insurers will come after you and make you do it, just like they did doctors. Yep. So if you start suing your small-town doctor because of malpractice, guess what? The malpractice insurers come back and say, you will be HIPAA compliant or you will not get malpractice insurance from us. And then the small-town doctor says, okay, the cost of not being compliant is now far, far less than the cost of, or the cost of not being compliant is far higher than the cost of being compliant.
It depends, on how strict the regulations are. So if regulation or fear of regulation can impact a positive change, and we've seen this in IoT, specifically when the FTC sued D-Link and said, you're producing really crappy routers, you need to do something about that. The very next week, Netgear announced their bug bounty program.
Right.
Now, a bug bounty program is not something like a recall that costs a lot of money, but it's a step in the right direction.
It's a gutsy move on the fact of Netgear. I mean, that is very.
I would like to see somebody file a bug bounty claim for finding a default credential, because how many times is that the way?
I think that that would be pretty easy for a lot of the vendors to basically say, "Look, we have in our manual that you need to change your password."
Well, that goes to the liability issue then, and that becomes, you know, well, we produced a device that could be secure, but you didn't follow the directions, you didn't follow the recommended settings, whether they were regulated or not.
Well, and also, like, the U.S. is only one country, right? These devices are being sold all over the world.
We're the only country. What are you talking about?
I know, it's America. We buy a lot of crap, don't get me wrong, so we can certainly impact change. But it's like environmental controls. If they're not being done worldwide, we're not getting the maximum effect out of that. So
we need to get
a
certain somebody to tweet about it. That's what's really going to change.
So actually, the reputational damage is a significant factor. So these overseas companies that were affected by this, including the DVR manufacturers, they actually did respond to the public outcry and the news articles and all of this attention being pointed to their brand to say, you people did this to us. And reacted. And
when it gets into Amazon product reviews, then it's bad.
Then it's evil.
Yeah. Then it impacts the bottom line.
Which is, again, economic.
I have to make a comment on legislation because the...
Not American. Go ahead.
There's a... Thank you. Thank you, Jeff, man. There's a specific issue with legislation and regulation around technology, and that is that technology moves very fast. So, you know, you can have a legislator set down some sort of standards, but those things can be out of date within 6 months, you know, or less.
But there's a difference between prescriptive and descriptive.
Take your point. And so, you know, that's where I was heading with a comment is you have to be very cautious in the way that you lay down these kind of guidelines to make sure that they're prescriptive, right, that they're very generalistic in nature and they set certain standards, but they don't actually get too specific in what they're mandating.
So could you see a home user being, as one of these guidelines, could you see a home user being required to buy cyber insurance?
I could see it as a rider under home. I could see it as a rider under homeowners.
Exactly.
Well, yeah. Drink twice, cyber and insurance.
But I don't think it necessarily needs to hit the consumer. I think there's incentive for a manufacturer to say I'm UL compliant, mm-hmm. and that affords certain luxuries. Right. Now, when we go buy a piece of electronics, most of us don't say, well is it UL? I mean, is it UL compliant?
But I do know that UL is moving into this space.
Yep.
Right now, they are, whenever you do UL certification, and we're on the board for that, is basically saying UL certifies that this particular component was put in compliance that they put forth. They're actually adding in cybersecurity components to that as well. Mm-hmm. So being a certifying body, that's great that they're stepping up to do that. But I still come back to, guys, I'm okay with the wild, wild west of IoT. We haven't solved home security. We won't. We haven't solved corporate security. We won't in our lifetimes, I don't think. And in many ways, this is okay. This is the trade-off of being a free society, being the internet, being what it is. And at some point, we have to basically say, we're going to take care of our own, the people that want to be secure. And hopefully those people will get rewarded. They'll continue to have business. They'll continue to move forward in the future. And eventually the people that don't get it right will go away. And I don't think that there's a solution to it. We just have to be.
So you're saying that the internet, going to be a crappy place, and it's going to the crappiest people.
Wonderful place.
Will fall off, and it'll be a less crappy place.
I found I'm good at one thing. Yeah. That's breaking things. The internet. Happy that is a job for me.
Now the truth comes out. Job security.
The internet will be a wonderful place full of crappy people.
Yeah. No, I think the internet is going to get to be a much more diverse and crappier place in our lifetimes before it gets to be a better place, to be honest, because, you know, we're seeing this massive diversity increase, just a massive diversity. Everybody's getting into the game and they don't know what they're getting into, certainly from a security perspective, right?
I think the important thing that John said was those that want to secure it can secure it. How? You know, my mom might want to secure it because she hears me talk about all the bad stuff I do all the time, but there's no framework, there's no open source community, there's no real good guide on, hey, I'm Mon Pa Shop, I do care about security, but I have no idea. My IT guy has no idea how to secure these IoT things that are important to my livelihood and my reputation.
Paul,
and now how do we develop that as a community to help?
And cyber insurance almost makes that worse, right? Because people can say, hey, I don't know how to secure this. I'll just buy cyber insurance because screw it. If I get hacked, I have insurance that'll cover it.
But that's not a solution.
Car insurance didn't
stop car accidents. Because if you've ever tried to file an insurance claim for anything, insurance providers fundamentally don't want to pay out.
Agreed.
And, you know, when it comes to cyber insurance, there's going to be some sort of review, some sort of due diligence. Did you do some sort of best practice?
Wait, somebody
else we're not going to pay out.
Somebody define for me what is cyber insurance. Are we talking consumer level?
Oh, I'd
love to take that.
Go ahead, John.
No, whenever someone you're dealing with cyber 30 insurance, seconds. There's someone a number of different types of cyber insurance. Whenever you have InGuardians or you have CounterHack or BHIS do work, you almost have a liability. You have to have a specific cyber insurance. It's kind of like arrows and emissions, but it's very specific to what we do. For a lot of other organizations, and we have to have this insurance as well, we have to have a cyber liability insurance if we get compromised and our customers' data is compromised. Now, whenever InGuardians or CounterHack or BHIS goes out and we try to get this insurance, the amount of documentation that we have to fill out, the procedures, the policies that we have to give them is not trivial. They go through and they review it, and they're like, well, you don't have a user awareness security program. You guys might want to look into that. And that's good. There's a bunch of people that are getting this insurance. I don't know who said it over here. You're absolutely right. I think you did. If you try to go in and you try to file and say, I just lost $50 million because we got hacked, pay me. And they're like, you didn't do a vulnerability management program.
Right.
And you filed out the document and said you did. There's no proof of that. They're not going to pay.
There's actually an existing case. I think it's still extant. Cottage Health was the name. They had a cyber incident. They filed for their policy for a payout from the insurance policy, and the insurer came back and said, in your policy document, which is a legal contract, you said that you would perform such and such a compliance regime, live up to this standard, whatever it was, and you actually picked this other standard and you were secure to that standard, but it wasn't the one you said you were going to do. Mm-hmm. So sorry, have a nice day, goodbye. So it's interesting that this kind of thing is already happening,
and it's going to happen more.
Well, and my point is, you know, for companies, and I'm coming from the PCI space.
Drink.
Where you know there's a certain element of there's no way to secure everything. I can't keep up with it, but I can just buy cyber insurance and I'll be done.
And we hear that.
I'll guarantee you, the insurance adjusters are going to be more granular, more demanding than any compliance, whether it's a QSA or a self-assessment.
And I think that they're going to drive more change in computer security in the industry than anything else. And it kind of goes back to Paul's opening question. He said, what is Security Weekly to you? And SANS is a big part of that for me, too. I think that with Security Weekly and with the SANS Institute, I have a platform to try to help organizations become secure. And it's interesting to me, like we talk to our customers, and we have a lot of customers, and I joke about it all the time, who do the things that we talk about in Security Weekly, who do the things that we talk about in our SANS class. And I talk about how security is improving as a whole, and I talk to other firms, and not in Gardens, because they kind of have the same pool of customers we do in a lot of ways. And they're like, no, things are horrible. Like, it's worse than it's ever been. And it's great to me that the people that we work with are actually improving.
They are absolutely being
on Security Weekly, and maybe for people that are listening to the show, doing your own security workshops in your own community, it has to start more local and grassroots, and Security Weekly is a big part of that.
Right, so and if you're just starting out in this industry, that's a really, really good tip. Mm-hmm. You know, start local, start learning things that you can, and once you're onto a space that you might not be comfortable in or you need help with, that's when you start reaching out. But you get really good at what you're local to, and you become known for what you're local to.
That's the way you reach end users, though.
Yes.
That's kind of back to that EMT kind of idea, is end users may want to do this, but a great number of them are not capable of doing it. And most of them are not capable of watching this show and figuring out what's going on. And there just are very, very few resources that are out there in the public to help. So if a mom and pop shop or just a person says, I don't know what to do here. I heard about this. I don't know what to do. What is IoT? Do we have a problem? We put all these thermostats up. There's nowhere for them to turn, because if they call a lot of us and they see the quote they get, they go, well, that's more than my annual budget, you know, just for the first visit. So they don't. Then they just say, okay, we just have to live with this, just like they always have with everything else. I mean, they do that with security, on physical security or whatever. But I think we need to focus a lot more on that sort of grassroots kind of development for those end users. And we have been working on that and talking to the states and talking to the government about how do we get resources like that available. So when somebody, I kept calling it, you call 911 if somebody's shooting at you. But who do you call if somebody's hacking you? And what number do you call then?
That's
7-1.
Well, I suggested 256 and 255 and
1337.
Somebody had to say that.
But in the reality, though, we do have people call us and say, I'm being attacked. Can you help me? And for individual users of small pop shops, there's no way we can help them.
No. So the vast majority of victims don't know they're being attacked.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So why bother with the discussion of who do you call when you figure out you've been attacked?
I don't know my routers.
The majority of people, somebody tells them, hey, by the way, you were hacked. But I wanted to touch on something John said. John said a very simple statement, but I think we could probably spend the rest of the time discussing what it means. What does it mean to be secure? Whether you're a company, large or small, what does that mean?
I'm most secure in my manhood.
We could discuss that for a while, too.
I would beg to differ.
I mean, I'm not secure.
Being secure, I don't believe, is a state. But I think most companies, organizations, and end users, consumers, think secure means I'm at this place where I'm secure. I think we understand the secure, being secure is something you do.
It's a process.
It's a process. Yeah. I say security is a verb. It's something you do. It's not a noun, something that you are.
Right. I want to table that for the next segment. We're going to talk about pen testing because I think it segues very nicely. So we're going to take a short break.
Are you going to ride the Segway?
Maybe. I'll segue into the next.
There we go.
Into the segue. Segue
into the segue.
Next segue.
You'll use the segue to segue into the segment.
That's right. About segues. Stay tuned. Bathroom break for everyone in the studio, by the way. That's what that means.